drink your milkshake.
It's gonna be okay.
Iran is not Iraq, and Iraq is not Iran. I know that.
That's great. Oh, that's great.
Open up, police.
I'll be right out.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to Real Time for the Real Everyday Movie Fan. I'm Ryan Murphy, and it's my great pleasure and privilege to be here with Academy Award nominated production sound mixer John Pritchett, a very esteemed person in his field who just called him. I sent him an email. He was like, okay. But Mr. Pritchett, thank you for being here. And why don't we start by telling the audience a little bit about what you do, what the production sound mixer does.
Okay, well, I am the production sound mixer on a show. There's only one person who does that. I have a crew, my boom operator, and a utility person. And we're responsible for recording all the stuff that happens on the set during the filming process. All the dialogue, all if there's any live music or anything like that that happens, playing back music, all those kinds of things, as well as making sure that everybody who needs to hear the dialogue can hear it with remote listening devices. And then my work.
I think we lost you there for a second. Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes. Everyone there can hear it. It was the last words I got. But your production sound mixer, you're responsible for all that good stuff. What was it that brought you into that profession? I mean, what made you, because I'm a film school grad myself, what made you to those sounds where I want to be in production sound specifically?
Yeah. Well, I started off my career as a recording engineer. Well, actually, I started off as a television cameraman. And I moved from that into recording because I was played in a band. I was the band that I was in college. We kind of formed a little recording studio on our own. And I sort of started doing that. Did that for several years, recording music, recording commercials, recording all kinds of things in the studio. And then at some point, I decided I needed to go freelance. There was not much money doing what I was doing. And so I went freelance. When I basically told people I could do this, I could do that, I could be a camera guy, I could direct, all those kinds of things, and just waited to see where I got most of the work. And most of the work came as a recording person. And so I did that. And I borrowed some money from a bored banker, a guy said he was tired of doing second mortgages and used car loans. And this sounded interesting to him. So I borrowed the money and bought a package. And then it's been just like that ever since. You know, it just grows and grows and grows. I did commercials for the longest time before I started doing television work, and then before I started doing movies. Small market, Dallas was a very small market. And started doing my first movie in 1979, I guess. So we're 41 years on, and I'm still doing it.
That's great. So no formal schooling of any kind?
I had not in engineering. My last years in college, I wound up doing broadcast film work, studying broadcast film. I had probably enough hours for a degree, but that wasn't my degree. I was still a psychology major. And I just really wasn't that interested in getting the degree in it. I just wanted to do the work. And so that was where my interest started on that. And television, went straight into television right out of school as a cameraman, which is weird. And I did some of that for a while and learned a whole lot of other things, learned a whole lot of stuff about the industry. But it was all an education that I got on the job. I did not study engineering or anything in school.
So then, go from just deciding to do that into kind of being getting to be very successful in Hollywood. Now, a lot of people who, you know, aren't well-versed, they might not realize there's a couple of people who share the glory when it comes to film sound. There's the production sound mixer, and then there's the re-recording mixers.
Yep.
Some very famous names happen to be Kevin O'Connell, the Minklers, those guys. And then, of course, you guys, the bunch of you, share in the Academy Award nomination or award for sound. So is there any relationship there? Do you ever talk to those guys, or you just...
Oh, no, we know. A lot of times those guys aren't hired until after my work is done. They come on frequently, you know, after production has happened. But sometimes they are brought on early, or there's a relationship with the director, so they know they're going to be the person. And so I'll have conversations with them. As soon as I'm able to contact them, I do. I usually start off by contacting the editors, though, first. This is the editors and so forth, because they're usually right there alongside us in a way, and start that conversation. And as soon as we know who's going to be doing post, then we open that conversation up. And a lot of times during post-production, they'll call me up or send me an email or something. Can I do this? Can I get something else, a sound effect or some kind of a thing? And so we do that sort of stuff.
Okay. Sounds good. So as I was, you know, preparing for this and looking through your sort of IMDb page, obviously you've done a terrific number of films, but I also noticed two things that really struck me. One was the amount of terrific directors you've worked with. And the other one was the recurrence that seems to happen. I guess directors have liked working with you. You've made 3 films with Robert Altman. I mean, at that point, most people would just be satisfied.
I made 7 films with Robert Altman.
Oh, you did? Okay. I guess I didn't see half of them. But,
some of them were pretty obscure. I'm going to guess that you probably never heard of The Utterly Mind-Roasting Summer of O.C. and Stiggs.
No, but I'm usually a pretty completist guy. I get on the Wikipedia pages and find all that stuff out. So I'm surprised. Yeah, that's...
He made a lot of movies that were great, and a lot of movies that nobody ever saw. That was one of them. But
I mean, we
try to have a relationship with them. You hope that you can work with them again. Mm-hmm. It's a matter of timing half the time, you know. I did a whole bunch of movies with David Mamet, and then we got out of sync. And I wasn't available for a bunch of them. So it just kind of goes like that. Mm-hmm. But you'd like the idea of working with somebody again. Mm-hmm. So I've done that. Yes, thanks. I've done it with a number of directors.
Yeah, I mean, I just counted right here. I was like Robert Altman. Both the films he's only made 2 of Tom Hanks. I had a couple films for Lawrence Kasdan. Several films for Paul Thomas Anderson. I mean, once you've made movies with Altman and Paul Thomas Anderson, half my friends in film school are like, okay, that's it. That's all he's got to do. You've actually, seems like your most prolific partnership has actually been with Larry Kasdan's son, Jake Kasdan.
Yep.
You just wrapped filming Jumanji 3 recently with. What's so special about that relationship with Jake?
I knew him. I did a number of films with Larry, his father. And on the last one we did, no, it wasn't the last one. It was like maybe the second one. I met Jake. He was a young fella and his younger brother, John, and just got to be kind of acquainted and friends doing that. And he would hang around with his dad, and he would do some extra work in the movies while working on his own idea of doing movies himself. And then when he started doing movies and television stuff, it was just kind of a natural thing. He just called me up, and we've had a great relationship ever since. I got passed on, as it were. Larry's not directing movies now. He's just writing, continuing to write. But Jake has got so many irons in the fire, and we've done, I think, 4 pictures and 3 television shows. So he's a terrific guy to work with.
Well, and also there's you've only made the one movie each with Sam Mendes and Rob Marshall, but those were your 2 Academy Award nominations.
Yep.
What was that like? Was that your first time in 2003 going to the Oscars? And just, what was that experience like for you?
Well, it was, as I tell everybody, you know, it's a great party. That's about it. It's flashy. And you know, the Oscars are really all about movie stars and personalities. And yes, those of us in the technical world get nominated or win awards and all that. And that's great. It's nice to see some recognition. But what I really take more pride in is getting recognized by my own people, by my own guild, the Cinema Audio Society. Is for us, for camera guys, it's the American Society of Cinematographers. And that's our peers. That's the people who really know what we're doing. And when you get honored by them, as I have been a couple of times, that really is what feels the best to me. I did get also a BAFTA nomination for There Will Be Blood, And that was really quite something special. And they really put on a show. It was good.
Yeah. So that brings up an interesting question. The whole being nominated thing is for most people, we go to see movies and we don't think about the sound, because I think generally speaking, the people who are doing it are competent, right? There's no one, we think so at least. So if you're looking at it from a more technical standpoint, what makes something worthy of praise? What goes into what you do that makes you, you're obviously in demand. What have you done that is talents, like what shows off your talent when you're on set?
Well, that's actually kind of hard to say. I mean, a lot of times directors and so forth, they just want to know there's no problems. Either the sound is usable or it's not. they don't often notice that it's extraordinary. Where I get all that recognition and so forth is from post-production. Post-production guys will call me up and say, this is the best stuff we've ever gotten or whatever. So they're the ones who really have to deal with it and work with it. And they're the ones that will come back and tell the director later on, this person was better than that person. How much did they have to loop? How much did they have to fix after the fact? And if I have any sort of thing to brag about, it's the fact that they tell me all the time that they hardly ever loop anything on movies that I do. Maybe that's true. But it also is important to know that the sound is not supposed to be noticeable. I mean, you're not supposed to go, oh my God, you know, that's the best dialogue I've ever heard in my life. If you could say I understood everything, then that's all I ever want to hear, is I could understand every word. A lot of times you can't. A lot of times it's not even important that you do. I mean, that's one of the things we have to ride this kind of delicate balance of getting something accomplished technically, but also getting it accomplished dramatically, because we don't want our actors to have to modify what they're trying to do a bunch in order to help us out. But at the same time, we sometimes have to go in there and modify what they're doing in order to get the track, in order to get something recorded properly. So I guess if I can say that I get more of that than somebody else, then maybe I do. I hear that I do, but you know, so again, I don't do post-production, so I don't know. What you want to believe is that if they're not complaining about it, you're doing okay.
Awesome. And this actually brings us back to a little bit, being a little bit more specific about exactly what you do, because some people in your field prefer their credit in the credits to be sound recordist, and others get production sound mixer. So there is mixing that goes on. Does that mean you're using different microphones and you're amplifying one more than the other and all that?
Well, recordist is typically English. That's typically a British name. But that's what they call their sound mixers. A recordist in this country, used to be at least, is a person who works with the recording equipment in post-production. They call them recordists. That doesn't mean anything. But the thing is, if I'm different than any of the new people today, is the fact that I came from the recording studio. So I mixed. I make a mix. And back in the days when I first started doing sound, there was no multi-track. Everything was one track, mono, you know, and if I had several microphones out there working, then I had to make a mix that could work, that could be used in the movie. Their tools were very limited back then as to what all you could do. So that's where I learned how to do it, to make a mix that was usable. And I still do that, even though they may go back and remix. Now we do everything multi-track, but they may go back and remix some of my stuff, but they start off with the mixed track that I gave them. If they use it for dailies, that's great. A lot of times, if it's totally usable, they'll use it. Maybe tweak it a little bit this way or that, but that's where I came from. And a lot of the guys today, I should say guys, a lot of the people today are not mixers. They're gatherers. You know, they record all the tracks. They have microphones, particularly in reality TV shows where there might be 15 or 20 people on wireless microphones. They're not going to make a mix. They're just going to get it all on track and then let post-production deal with it. That's never been my style. I mean, I will always make a mix best I can. And then they still have all those ISO tracks of all of the wireless mics or whatever, all the microphones separate. They can remix it if they want to.
So the mixing doesn't really occur in the moment. Like you after the scene has been shot and cut has been yelled, you go back and you mix it a little bit yourself, or?
No. As I said, I'm making a mix as we go along.
As you go along.
And then my stuff goes immediately to post-production, goes through a space where they synchronize it with the video, if it's video or film, and they put those things together, and then that's handed over to the editors. And the editors, the film editors, not the sound editors, the film editors get it first. And they will, because the way we work today, they will make some kind of rough mixes to go with what the picture that we're seeing. Some editors are more involved in it than others. I just did these two Avengers movies, and the editor on that movie was so good at doing all these kinds of things. He would make beautiful mixes and show them to us, as, you know, just to let everybody know what he's doing, because he really liked going in there and doing that same stuff. And he loved the stuff I would give him because it was a mix that he could start with. And then if he wanted to tweak it, he could do that. He would add sound effects. He would add music, all kinds of stuff, even though it's not the finished product. Then after he's done with it, then it goes into the hands of sound post-production. And that's where all the other stuff gets done.
Right.
So, yes, to answer your question, I do mix, but it may not be the mix that you hear in the movie.
Yeah, gotcha. So, like, and then the editor in question, I've been watching all, I think it's Jeff Ford you're talking about, because I pay attention to who does what and everything, but if you've watched any of the interviews with the Russo brothers lately, they just keep talking about Jeff Ford and what a great storyteller he is. So yeah, there
he's
you go.
Great. He's fantastic in that he really isn't just cutting the movie. He's telling the story. I mean, he's actually putting it together with under their aegis. But he's very influential. He's also the one we did like 7 weeks of reshoots on this thing because of so many things that he came up with that would make the movie better that we needed. So we came back and did all these reshoots because of him. Yeah, he's brilliant.
That's great. And I want to talk about Avengers, obviously. You can't, it's we're in the middle of it being the biggest movie of all time. So I can't talk to the sound mixer on that without talking about those films. But real quick, before I get into that, just again, moving along on your filmography, I did notice from about 2014 to 2017, you kind of stepped away from movies a little bit and got into television a lot. And what was the reason for that? And how was television? I mean, obviously, it works faster.
Wasn't exactly a choice. The industry has been through kind of an uproar in the past, I'd say 10 years, when production would not go to a place because they wanted to shoot there. They'd go there because there was tax money, tax incentives. Mm-hmm. California, which is where I'm based, even though I live in Texas, I'm hired out of California. The film industry there basically just dried up because there was no incentive money. They stopped giving incentive money to productions. And so the productions went where the money was, which is why
we paused there for a second. He'll be back in 2 seconds. This is the connection loss.
And I still see you and hear you.
Okay. So we got you back. So there was no incentive money in California.
Well, that's the thing. And so consequently, so much of the work has gone to Atlanta, Georgia.
Yeah.
Some of it to New York, some of it to a few other places. And one by one, a lot of these states out there that had incentives, they've given them up for whatever reason. Some are coming back. New Mexico has started to reinstate that stuff. But California didn't do it for the longest time. So consequently, I was not getting any film work because there wasn't any film work. I couldn't be hired in Atlanta, Georgia, because part of how you get incentive money is by hiring as many locals as you can in any market, right? So it's a matter of saving money and getting this incentive money. So the productions would go there and maybe want to use me for it. But then the studios would say, well, you can't hire him because he doesn't live there. Fortunately, this changed about 3 years ago. And they realized that their pool of talent was spread pretty thin. Some really good people there. There really are now particularly. But there just weren't the people that these directors wanted to use. And so they just kind of bucked the system and said, we're going to hire who we want. And so, like I said, for the past 3 years, most of my work has been in Atlanta. And that's where we did the Avengers, except for a month in Scotland. Now, production, there's a little bit of money that's happening again in California, a little bit. So some films like Avatar, the new Avatar, is being shot in California. It's starting to happen. But television never slowed down there. Television was always going. It still is. People like Jay Kasdan doing, you know, New Girl and shows like that, and then Fresh Off the Boat and all that, that has been very, very busy stuff. It kept me busy a little bit during that time.
And so now we can talk about the Avengers, which is the big hot button thing at this point. Obviously, now again, I'm a nerd when it comes to film crews, knowing Jeff Ford, knowing the names of the people involved. I love knowing who's doing what, and you can't get into that with the Russo brothers without noticing that they have really kept a lot of their crew. A lot of their main principal crew, you see the same names, same costume designer, same cinematographer, same this, same that. You came in there. They had the same Peter Hillidal was Peter the Hiddell. Sound person on their. I'm sorry.
It's Leadall, but yeah, yes.
Yeah. I figured I was butchering his name. He was their sound mixer on the first two Marvel movies they did, and then I was maybe just the scheduling didn't work out or whatever. And they so in came you. Was that an interesting experience? You have enough experience in your life to have had a lot of experiences, but was that an interesting experience to come on to a sequel in which a lot of the crew and a lot of the cast were such a well-oiled machine and knew each other so well before you ever got there?
A lot of these people I knew as well from other movies. A lot of those people I worked with before, the first AD and so forth, the people that I know, and the producer, the line producer, is one of my dearest friends. That's the reason I got invited, because Peter Leadall actually retired.
Okay.
Otherwise, he would have been on it, because they are very loyal to people. But a good friend of mine, the producer, wanted to bring somebody on that he thought they would like, and I'd done so many shows with Michael Grillo. That's how I got in, and we all got along swimmingly. It's a great, one of the most professional crews I have ever worked with, in every department. An astonishing bunch.
Well, you have to, because it's a big deal. You're not shooting something in your backyard when you're, you know. No. So they got the best for what they, and that's terrific. True.
But when you're talking about a first unit crew every day of 500 people, and a second unit of about 400 people, it's inevitable with a lot of those people I knew. There's just so many of them that I'd worked with them before, one way or another. And they will work with the Russos again, but the Russos may be changing course a little bit. I think they may be wanting to do some much smaller projects, at least for a while.
Yeah.
And if I can do those, I'll do those.
Yeah. Well, you can't see, you talk about getting to know the same people. It seems like you can't get away from Karen Gillan. Like,
Yeah, we love Karen.
Just bounce back from Jumanji to Avengers to back to Jumanji, and she's kind of winning whatever you do. So that's kind of something I noticed, but yeah.
Yeah, no, and she's tremendous. And she's also directed two of her own movies now. Mm-hmm. One's on the festival circuit, and the other one is, I think, going to be on iTunes. But she's a director in her own right. She's very talented and just a lovely person to be around.
That's terrific. And then... obviously, you shot these films largely in 2017. Throughout 2017, they came back and did reshoots. They stopped filming, and then they filmed the big finale, the big battle, about a year later. And then they did reshoots in January of this year, which you just said you were a part of.
No, not the reshoots this year. Came back. I did the stuff in 2018. I mentioned we did 7 weeks of reshoots back in Atlanta. Mm-hmm. And then they said that was it, they were done. And then I got a call in January, could I come out to LA for 5 days to do something else? And I said, you really? You're not done? But I couldn't do it because I was doing this Jumanji. But they did come back and shoot more stuff, including some pieces that we didn't even know about. Yeah. I mean, it was the most secretive operation ever. The actors didn't know what they were going to be saying each day until they got their sides.
So. That's crazy. Yeah, and then they hire, I guess, Lee Orloff, the great Lee Orloff, to do the pickup shoots, which is another person I'm a big, again, being a nerd, you can't not know the guy you turn near to, but,
he's great. Lee and I know each other pretty well, and we've done some seminars together, and he's tremendous.
And that's what I kind of figured is that, you know, you all know each other. You talk about Peter Leadall and Lee Orloff and a lot of these guys who Marvel has worked with and that are the big, names. And I think that's really cool. You guys definitely seem to have a community just from based on this. So,
well, it's interesting. We do and we don't. I mean, obviously, we don't work with each other. Mm-hmm. We do the same job. And if we have, usually how we find out about each other so with this by our utility person. We used to call him a cable person on our crew, who often we don't use the same person. Again, if they want us to hire a local in an area that we're going to go, then we have to do that. That's how they get their money. But those guys will have worked with other mixers. And so we learn from those guys about what somebody else is doing or somebody's not doing. You know, it's our way of comparing. And then we will meet each other at some convention or some seminar thing. And then we'll get to talk about what we do directly with the Lee Orloffs and so forth.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's great. And, just bringing up stuff to the present, you just finished Jumanji 3. Seems like you have a little bit of a respite now. Is there any knowledge about what you're doing next?
Yeah.
Nothing you can
like
talk
everything
about.
Else you can't talk about it, but yes, I'm probably going to be doing another Tom Hanks movie.
Wow. Okay. That's okay. Well, I guess we'll just have to wait and see what happens there. And last, before we go, before I thank you and send you off, nowadays, people like myself will go to film school. They'll specialize in all these departments. What would you say to someone who's looking to get into film if you can recommend production sound and what they should do to get be a part of that, and what's so great about it that keeps you coming back?
Well, I tell when I go, first thing I do when I go talk to classes that I do sometimes at colleges and so forth, I typically tell them, if you want to get started in the film business, start in the smaller market. Austin used to be a great place to start, not so much anymore, but smaller markets. Dallas was a good place. That's where I got started, because you need to be in a place where you can, let's say, make your mistakes first before you venture out to California or even to Atlanta nowadays. Start small and get some credits, because all anybody in the world of what I do, all anybody wants to see is what you've done. They don't really care about your education. If you're an art department, you know, a costume designer or a production designer, then knowing that you have an education in that is important. But for the rest of us, it's really knowing what you've done. They just want to see your resume. And so building a resume is super important, even if it's just the smallest of things. You say, I did this, I did that, I was a boom operator on something. And that gives you credibility. And the other thing is, meet as many people as you can who do this sort of work. There's a young lady who I kind of mentored, who went around, literally traveled to different parts of the country to meet people to do this work. And then she came to me because she happened to live in Austin at the same time. And then I helped her and pushed her into Atlanta. And now she's being very successful in Atlanta, because we all know a lot of the same people. It's as much, I hate to say this, but it's as much who you know as it is how good you are. Mm-hmm. I know a lot of people out there, a lot of guys who do what I do, whose reputations maybe aren't perfect, but they know so many people. You know, they know, so they know producers and all kind of stuff. And the other side of that is, we help each other. If I can't do a job because I'm booked on something else, then I will try to recommend to whoever it is the best person I can find. That's another thing. Never recommend anybody who's not at least as good as you or better. Because that's what they're going to remember you by.
Awesome. Well, Mr. Pritchett, hang on a quick sec, because I want to thank you and thank you properly after I turn the camera off. But that'll do us for today. And I just want to thank you on camera for being so kind and generous with your time and for being a part of such a great system.
Well, thanks for calling me, Ryan. We appreciate it. Appreciate the interest, man.
All right, that'll do us for today, folks. Mr. John Pritchett, Academy Award nominated production sound mixer in Hollywood. Let us know what you thought, and as always, thank you for keeping it real with Real Time.